instruction. In addition to being a third grade and fourth grade teacher, I was a reading specialist for 5 years or so in elementary school. I worked with kids in kindergarten through fifth grade, but primarily the young kids, K to two, really, is where I spent most of my time. So I really enjoy talking about the writing-reading connection at this age level. It's a lot of fun. And I hope that I present some strategies that can be really useful for you guys. As John said, if you want to jump in and unmute yourself and talk with me at times, that'd be great. I like interaction, and I feel like that's where some really good learning happens, and I think it'll be good for the audience on the webinar too. So today I'm going to talk about writing as a tool for foundational reading or improving foundational reading skills. And there we go. And the content that I'm going to talk about, really, there's so much work in this area. I put a list of authors here. These are some collaborators of mine that have worked on several papers around these kinds of skills. But all of that work is based on lots of other literature. Lots of other research and experiments and interventions. I'm pulling from some of the papers that we wrote together, but I want to sort of say that there are a lot of other researchers cited in a lot of the other works that we do, especially this meta-analysis in 2010 that I'll talk about in a minute. There are a lot of folks who've done work in this area. So the strategies that I'm going to talk about are really strongly evidence-based. So the purpose of this module is to highlight how teachers like you can use writing to improve foundational reading skills. And so a lot of times what we think about is how reading can inform writing. If we have mentor texts or we teach kids reading skills, then they get interested in writing. And a lot of times we think maybe reading comes before writing. And I would say that it does. There's really a reciprocal relationship, but writing can be used as a tool to improve reading. And so what we're going to focus on are relationships between like handwriting skills, letter knowledge, and letter sound correspondence, things like spelling and phonics, and sentence construction and reading fluency. And I'll talk to you guys about how those things are tied together and how we can use writing to kind of foster those reading skills. So we've got a little bit of an agenda. This is just like sort of an order. I just like to give people a little bit of an idea of what we're going to do. And so first, I'm going to sort of establish a little bit of a foundation for why writing instruction might improve reading. And then I'm going to provide an example of student writing that we'll use as a basis for sort of talking about skills and the skills instruction that we might want to do. And then we're going to consider a little activity around how to build automaticity. Really, it's like what automaticity is and then how writing can help foster that. And then we'll examine a little bit of evidence for foundational writing skills. And although those four things are, four out of five, really, the bulk of our time is going to be spent on learning practical strategies for teaching handwriting, spelling, and sentence combining in ways that can be, foster reading skills. So, one of the things that when we talk about reading, we think usually about phonological awareness, phonemic awareness, phonics skills, decoding, fluency, reading comprehension, vocabulary. We talk about all of these big five skills around reading, but one overlooked avenue for enhancing early reading skills is also writing. So why might writing be useful for improving reading skills? Well, reading and writing are, inherently linked, right? They're inherently connected. They draw upon the same common knowledge and cognitive processes. And so consequently, if we improve writing skills, we should result in improved reading skills. Fitzgerald and Shanahan in 2000 really sort of conceptualized this as like reading and writing are two buckets drawing water from a common well, right? And that's really, so if you think about it, we've got these different skills, we've got these two buckets, but we're pulling on some of the same cognitive resources when we use it, those skills. But, and that seems pretty simple, but it can be a lot more complex, right? So this is a model from Yong-Suk Kim that she developed in 2020. It's called the Interactive Dynamic Literacy Model. And I like to show this because I like to, you know, to show all the complexity around reading, right? I'm going to talk about foundational skills, which is this sort of big box on the left here, you know, where it says lexical literacy and handwriting, foundational literacy, where it's got word reading, spelling, handwriting, orthography, phonology, morphology. But of course, reading involves emotion and motivation. It involves oral language skills. It involves working memory, attentional control, discourse knowledge. All of these things work together and in an interactive way. And one of the things, if you have the time to read this paper from Yong-Suk Kim, it's in my references, really talks about how these skills work together in really complex ways, right? So what does that mean? You know, how can we simplify reading for kids, right? Sometimes when we're asking kids to write, and if they have difficulty with transcription skills, sometimes we might be overtaxing their working memory, and we might see, you know, like a computer will tell us, there's not enough memory to complete this operation. Usually kids don't have the verbal skills or the self-awareness to be able to say, I don't have enough memory to complete this task. So we see it in other ways. We see it in, like, you know, their attention. We see it in their behaviors and things like that. Here's another picture that I put together. What I like to think of it rather than two buckets drawing from the same well, sort of like when we're, you know, we all have these outlets at home where we, like, John and I were just talking about it, ironically, before people came on, about how we got all these plugs underneath our desks, right? And they're all over the place. And really they're drawing on the same, you know, power source, right? And what happens when we overload that power circuit? Well, sometimes we'll blow the fuse, right? We'll blow the fuse box, or we'll have the circuit breaker, be broken. And then we'll have to go and, like, either unplug things and then reset the circuit breaker and all that stuff. And, you know, we see this in writing again with this frustration that you can see from this child in the picture here. And so I usually think of, like, here's the writing plug, here's the reading plug, here's all the other cognitive resources that I showed in that interactive dynamic literacy model. So what does this look like for a student? You know, so I wanted to kind of show, you know, grade four student with a reading disability, and kind of show how what writing might look like for a student who's overloaded like that. And so, you know, you can see that the types of tests here are, like, word identification, word attack, reading comprehension, you know, so mostly reading, but then we also have this writing essay composition subtest. And you can see the percentile rankings on the right-hand side. So this student is really, you know, having difficulty with all of these skills, maybe a little bit better in the writing arena there, but still, you know, below average in all of these areas. So let's take a look at Jordan's writing. Here's the example. So I typed it out below, but I wanted you to see the handwriting as well. It's really important, I think, sometimes to see what kids are doing with their mechanics and the legibility of their work. And remember, this is a fourth grade student, right? So the game is battleships. I like it because I get to play with friends, and I like ships because they're big. Playing with friends are fun to play with them, but I usually win, right? So what are your impressions of this writing sample? If you're analyzing this, what would you say are the things that Jordan is having difficulty with? You can feel free to put it in the chat. Or,
yeah, I was gonna say, come in, you can come off of mute and speak up, or put it in the chat, folks, but. Phonics rules, I see from Tanya.
Phonics rules. Okay, so Tanya, what do you mean by phonics rules? What are some of the things that you you know, let's what are some of the examples here?
Well, as a reading specialist, we work on, we call them the hunks and chunks, which are, you know, those important things that they see in the words all the time, and they just need to remember that, you know, what are all the different combinations that make long A? What are all the different combinations that make long E? And so on and so forth. So I'm noticing, like with playing, you know, P-L-A-I-N-G seems, you know, very straightforward, but he's just missing that part where you have to have those combinations to keep it a long vowel.
Right. And, you know, and that's a really great point. One of the things that, you know, I have in my notes here to talk about is the word playing, right? So seems like this student is, you know, we in a lot of words that end in Y, we drop the Y and add IES, right? And so in this case, maybe overgeneralizing the rule for dropping the Y, but it's such a common word, play and playing, that, you know, it's a little surprising to see that. That difficulty with that word.
Yeah, especially since he got play correct in the rest of the story. So
So maybe overgeneralizing a little bit of a rule. They're trying to follow the rules, but having some difficulty with that.
It seems like his word choice is pretty simple for a fourth grader. And I'm wondering if the simple word choice is because he doesn't know how to spell or use some of the larger words he might be able to speak.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. So I think that we see that a lot with children. They avoid using some more challenging words in their vocabulary because they're not really sure how to spell them. Right. And you can see this a little bit, even with some of the high frequency words like friends. Right. Clearly hasn't, you know, this is fourth grade. We would expect students to maybe know that word, friends, but having trouble remembering to add that E in there. So probably if he's having trouble with words like friends, also would have trouble with more challenging vocabulary, right? And then that might impact. I think that's a really good insight, John. It will impact, you know, the ideas and their word choices and the complexity of their writing, right? What else? Yeah, I was thinking that there might be a little bit of, like, you know, maybe some executive function skills here, like not really sort of like maybe some working memory challenges. Remember, I had that, you know, there's memory overload, right? So you see this a little bit in the repetition of reasons, right? So I like it because I get to play with friends, and then playing with friends are fun to play with, you know? So you can see that there's a little bit of difficulty there. And then also in that sentence, playing with friends are fun to play with, right? So it seems like it's a little bit of circular, you know, not really circular logic, but like circular reasoning, right? So where the student is sort of saying playing with friends are fun to play with, and maybe isn't really thinking about, you know, how those ideas go together, right? And maybe just sort of being a little bit repetitive there. Maybe it could be because, you know, having difficulty with the word playing, writing the word or spelling the word playing and spelling the word friends, you know, so potentially that's something that's inhibiting there.
Stephanie mentioned just the lack of spacing between the words.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, so you can see that this student is having difficulty with mechanics. You know, the spacing is very clear to see. There's also just, you know, I think not really smooth letter formation, right? You can see this in like the letter A in the, whoops.
I'm not sure if this was mentioned already, but I have one of my special ed teachers that would say, all the sounds are there, even though the words are spelled phonetically, all the sounds in the word are represented.
Right, right. Absolutely. So the student is really thinking about sounds, really is really trying to represent those. Yeah, absolutely. So there are some really good things here too. But I did want to sort of like, again, sort of point out that really you can see it in like the letter A in the, you know, whenever you see a letter A or the letter G, you know, it looks like the student has difficulty with letter formation, right? So this letter formation is not automatic. And because that's not automatic, it's probably taking up some of those cognitive resources too, right? So then can't, you know, if the student is like thinking about how do I form these letters, or I'm having difficulty with that, then that's going to sort of not allow the student to focus on the spelling skill or spelling of the words. And with these words so close together, probably is going to have the student may have difficulty reading back what they wrote, and then not really be able to revise their ideas here, right? So a lot to think about, a lot to unpack with Jordan. I love to look at students' writing because I feel like, you know, I can learn a lot about them from it. So, you know, we noticed this, Jordan's transcription skills and, you know, EF difficulties are probably limiting what, you know, the ideas that he's coming up with. There's a big working memory burden, and then difficulty remembering and organizing ideas. And so, so that leads to sort of a lack of goal setting and planning. And then, you know, of course, the working memory burden also then, you know, creates difficulty monitoring spelling and conventions. So what can we do for Jordan? Well, there's really like sort of two things that we need to do. And this is really challenging as teachers, right? We have to remediate the skills, right? We have to teach Jordan these skills, right? We've got to provide instruction and intervention to help the child improve in those skill areas, spelling, handwriting. And one of the things is, you know, a big goal for me would be to get to automaticity to reduce the cognitive load. However, you know, what we tend to do is we focus, hyper-focus on that sometimes. And then we're so focused on like those foundational skills that we don't really help the students work on their idea generation and those higher level thinking skills that are also important for writing. So another thing that we might want to do is think about how we can help provide accommodations to help the student compensate for some of those challenges when they're writing. How can we reduce the cognitive load? And the purpose of doing that would be to help them focus on a different skill, right? So compensate for spelling and handwriting so that we can focus on idea generation or organization or things like that. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about both of those types of strategies throughout the presentation. One major thing that, you know, I think is really important is automatizing foundational skills. If we can do that, we reduce cognitive load and it allows the kids to focus on higher order skills. And so when we remediate, we really, our goal should be to automatize. And I want to talk about what automaticity is. And so we're going to do a little activity. And John, I'm going to pick on you, and I'm going to have you do this activity with me. So in the following slides, you're going to see a series of color names. And so in this game, you're going to name the color of the letters as accurately as possible. So, you know, here are a couple of examples. In the word blue, the color of the letters is blue, right? So you'll say blue. It also happens to be the word is blue, right? In the word dog, the color of the letters is what?
Is red.
Red. So you'll say red in that case. So yeah. You're focused on saying the color of the letters. All right. So we're going to do this. We're going to do this a couple times. We're going to start off with this list here. What I'd like you to do is just say the color, just go down the list and say the color of the word. So go down the first column and then the second column.
Red, yellow, green, blue, red, blue, yellow, green, blue, red, green, yellow.
Okay, great. How do we think he did? How did you feel about that, John?
Okay, there was one point I got a little tripped up in the letters because you're reading the words at the same time.
I mean, yeah, your brain will tend to do that a little bit. So, you know, so let's try this actually when we're looking at some color words, okay? So in this case, so go ahead and try to say the color of the letters again, remember.
Okay. Red, yellow, green, blue, red, blue, yellow, green, blue, red, green, yellow. I mean, there. So, okay, that was simple enough because I was expecting to be tripped up. Yeah.
Slowed me up. You're anticipating my next round of this. So you were, I could tell you were like waiting for it to be different.
Yeah.
And these are all congruent. So these are all the same. And I bet if you do this again, we'll give you another shot at it. Let's do it as fast as you can now this time.
Red, yellow, green, blue, yellow, green, blue, red, green, yellow.
Okay, great. So you can see that, you know, you can do that pretty quickly. You know, you were trying to anticipate something else. And so that slowed you down a little bit. So now I'm going to give you an incongruent one. And so this is going to be the challenging one where you're going to, the colors won't necessarily match the word. All right. So let's go for it.
Yellow, green, blue, red, green, yellow, blue, red, green, yellow, blue, red.
Very nice job. So everybody like snap for John or you know, platform or whatever. Nice red, job. Red, thanks red, for red. Being my guinea pig.
Yeah, right.
Now let's talk about it. Sometimes I touch my mouse and it will, it's a little sensitive, I guess. What was the challenge here? Why was this, you were a little slower. Daria said you did it faster than she could. Why is that? Why is this one slower? What's the challenge?
It conflicts with the word itself, with the meaning of the word itself or what it represents.
Sure, sure. So what is your brain trying to do?
Trying to read the words.
Right.
I think it's a switching task.
It is. This is actually like a you know, an inhibition control type of a task. It's an EF task, and I'm using it to make a slightly different point. But you're right on. You have to inhibit a prepotent response, and then say a different response, right? And the prepotent response here is reading, right? And it's prepotent, meaning that it's automatic. It is very difficult. When you see a word that you know how to read, it is very difficult to stop yourself from reading that word, right? Mm-hmm. If I flashed up the word stop on the screen and I said, don't read this word, everybody would like automatically read the word. You wouldn't be able to stop yourself from reading the word because you're all expert readers. You have automaticity. And that's what I'm after with kids, right? So one of the things I really want to do is try to get them to that level of automaticity, right? We see that kids who are in kindergarten can do this task actually pretty well. They don't have as much trouble as John did here because they don't have the automaticity of the word reading yet, right? And so it's actually not a great task for measuring inhibition for young children. But that's what I'm after, is that automaticity, so that we can see a word and just know it. Because if we can do that, then we can focus on comprehension, right? We can focus on organization of ideas. We can focus on making inferences or making a plan. And so that's why I'm really like focused on automaticity. So, well, how do we get there, right? Well, writing is a good way in. You know, one of the things that I know is that writing and reading are linked, as we mentioned. And I know that I'm like not a great speller. But I'm an expert reader, but I don't always spell well, right? I still make mistakes in my spelling. I see the red line pop up on Microsoft Word all the time. Like, oh, and it could be that I have poor typing skills, but it also could be that I just have some, there's some words that I still have difficulty spelling, right? So you can be a really great reader and not a great speller, but if you can spell a word, you can read that word, right? And so that's something that I really want to get across. So if we can have kids spell words.
I really need to be paying attention to this training, and I'm missing it.
So I don't think that was for us, but that's okay. All right, so I'm going to talk about this meta-analysis called Writing to Read. It is a report that we did. What we did basically is, well, I think I've got it on the next slide here. We statistically summarized the experimental literature. So what I did was I went out with, and Steve Graham and I, we collected every experiment that we could find that looked at the impacts of writing on reading outcomes. And what we did was we collected them all And then we sort of created an average. And so one of the goals of that is to sort of answer the answer a specific question and get an average effect size. So what is an average effect size? Well, it's really sort of complicated, but I wanted to just simplify it and kind of just give you an idea of what it means. So if we have an experiment with three students or six students, we might have like three students in the treatment group and three students in the control group. And then what you see here is that the treatment group ends up a little higher than the control group. So we've got a difference of about, you know, 5 points on the exam. But then in experiment two, we've got 10 students, right? We've got five in the treatment and five in the control. And what we see there is actually the control group does a little better by about a point. And then in experiment three, we've got, seven students in the treatment group and seven in the control. So a little bit bigger, and we have a difference of 3 points favoring the treatment group. Now, I could just average these numbers and I can say, well, what's the average difference, right? But an average weighted effect size really sort of takes into consideration lots of other factors, like how well controlled was the experiment and how big were the groups, right? If I have the whole population, if I have like, you know, thousands of kids, I'm probably going to see, you know, like what the actual effect is there is going to be a little closer than if I have a really small sample. And so what we try to do is we average the effect size across the groups. And so that's what we did. When we did that, we got an effect size. And so, you know, effect sizes are really simple. I mean, they're really complex, but I'm going to really simplify it for you, where if we have an effect size of 0.80, we're dancing on the moon. It's something that we're like, this is a huge effect. It makes a really big difference for kids. If we have an effect size of 0.5, we're dancing on top of the Empire State Building. And then if we have an effect size of 0.25, we're dancing on the street. Now we're still dancing. It's still an important effect. It's still an important difference, but it's not quite as big as a 0.80, right? So that's just a basic rule of thumb. Now, what does that mean? Well, if you want to like sort of think about it on the normal curve, what we would say is, if you had an effect size of one, you know, we would basically, what we'd be doing is bringing a student from the 50th percentile all the way up to the 84th percentile. So that's a pretty big jump. You're taking a student who's exactly at the average, right? Exactly 50th percentile and going all the way up to the 84th percentile. It's a huge jump. We don't usually see that kind of big jump in education research. So 0.80, you can see, would be, that would probably get us to around the 70th or 75th percentile. And so that's a really big jump too. And so that's why an effect size of 0.8 is really large. So what do we do? I told you we collected all of the literature and we had some criteria, right? We couldn't just include everything. We had to be really clear that, you know, what we were looking for really isolated this impact of writing on reading. And so what we did is we collected only experiments or quasi-experiments. The treatment group had to write or get writing instruction. And then in the comparison group, there had to be no writing, right? They couldn't write. So then there was nothing different other than writing. So basically the treatment group got writing, the control group didn't. Maybe they got similar instruction in other ways, but there wasn't anything different otherwise. And then they had to test reading. So there had to be a reading assessment at the end. It had to involve students in grades 1 to 2, and they had to have this data to calculate those effect sizes that I was telling you about. And so what do we see? Here are our results. We've got, we were only able to sort of break down specific skills. We had some overall effects that we share, but I wanted to break down specific skills for you, right? So does teaching spelling strengthen word reading skills? We found a bunch of studies in grades 1 to 5 that looked at this, and the effect size of point was 0.68. So where are we dancing? What do you think? Remember my dancing analogy?
You're in New York City now.
Yeah, we're actually above the, we're like maybe on a, we're on a ship on the way to the moon. We're not quite there, but we're on the way out, right? And then does writing instruction improve reading fluency? We got an effect size of 0.79. So more dance on the moon there. So that's a huge effect, right? So basically what we've shown is across all of this literature, on average, if kids are writing about or getting writing instruction, their reading skills are improving, right? So that's just the evidence, right? So now what I've done is I'm going to pull some activities from the research that are based on this evidence, right? So one recommendation is that that I want to sort of, really emphasize is to teach handwriting skills. Teaching handwriting skills can improve letter recognition and letter sound correspondence, especially when we do when we add some activities, some specific activities in. So here are some ways that we would want to teach handwriting skills. We would teach letters in groups by shape. So you can see A, E, and O there on the left, or I, L, and T. And what we do is we will group those because the formation of the letters is similar in certain ways, right? And so you want to teach the kids how to form those letters and give them a lot of practice with those letter strokes so that they can get really automatic with them, right? So that's one thing that we might do. Another recommendation we've seen in literature is to provide visual cues, right? So showing students, what direction their pencil should go in. I think that we saw in Jordan's writing, if you looked at the G, I could guarantee it, it was one continuous stroke. So it either went up from the top right of the letter and drew a G this way, or went from the bottom and drew it up, right? Neither of those is really the appropriate stroke, right? And so, and it's not really efficient. And so, what we want to do is teach kids, what direction and give them automaticity for how to create that stroke. Another thing that we would do is provide tracing or guides. So, you can see this example here, we would write the letter inside the lines. So it helps kids sort of stay within a line. The lines, and not to sort of have that really sort of messy handwriting, and then provide structured copying practice. You can see in this example the ape ate one orange. It's in context. We're actually practicing this skill when writing real words, and we're showing. We have an example here. Student doesn't have to come up with the ideas. They don't have to come up with the spelling of the word, so they can focus on just the letter formation here, and then really focus on how do I create those letters. And then you notice that in all of those words, the letters that we've taught, A, E, and O, are all sort of repeated multiple times in those words, right? So giving the student a lot of practice in context. Another thing that we might want to do is to introduce grapheme-phoneme correspondence. So as we're teaching kids how to form a letter, we might also say, hey, you know what? We have this opportunity to talk about the letter sound, right? So here's today's sound spelling. The sound is f. What sound? And then the students will say f, right? Then we'd say, good. The spelling of the sound is f. What's the spelling? The student says, the spelling of the sound is F. What is the spelling F? Sorry about that. Our special clue card helps us remember this sound spelling. What is this a picture of? And of course, it's a flower. Flower helps us remember that the F. And so we've seen this in several spelling interventions. And it really helps the students remember, sort of the shape of the letter. So what's this picture of? It's a flower. Flower helps us remember F, all right? And then we say, inside the flower, you see the spelling of F for the sound. What's the clue? What is the sound and what's the spelling? And so the student would say flower, F, right? And then we move on to say, now I'm gonna show you some words and say them. If you see F and hear F, you hold up your flower clue card. So we're showing them what the shape of the letter looks like, and we're attaching the sound to it. Now, this particular thing that I'm showing you here is from one of my students, former students. She's a professor at the University of Tennessee now. She was a teacher of dyslexia for 28 years, and she came up with this idea for an intervention where kids pair phonics instruction with handwriting, and we do that to help kids make the connection. So you can see we have kids tracing each letter or letter pattern or you know, grapheme while saying the sound of the letter. So they'll still trace TH and they'll say th, and they'll trace it and they'll say th, trace it, th, right? And we're really emphasizing the stroke of the letter. So she teaches the kids the stroke of the letter. And then after they've done some tracing, then she has them write the letter across the lines while saying the sound. So they'll write it and they'll say th, write it and say th, right? That's right. And so Allison sort of says the picture of the flower and the shape of the letter, or the shape, yeah, shape of the letter gives the child something like a hook for the letter name to hook onto. And that, and she's asking if that's helpful for children with dyslexia. And yes, it is, according to the research that we've found. And so that's one of our recommendations for students with dyslexia. Here's an example. Lesson sequence around this, right? So we're teaching, and I want to point out that we're talking about handwriting here still, right? So we have the grapheme sequence. We might teach TH and CH. We're teaching the phoneme th and ch, right? We're teaching those phonemes. And then we might dictate words like that with chest, right? And then we have another lesson where we're dictating words inch, thick, chat, right? And the students have to think about those sounds, how they go into the letters, and think about how to represent those sounds with the letter patterns, and they're practicing their handwriting at the same time. And then in addition, then she, you know, after they get pretty good with those phonemes, then she'll ask them to use it in a sentence or use those skills in a sentence as they're practicing sort of this dictated sentence, and they're really thinking about the sounds. We didn't want to use copied sentences. So one of the things that Pam said was like, I don't want to use copied sentences because the kids don't have to think about the sound. So she goes with dictated sentences here and asks the kids to really think about the sounds that they're representing, right? After kids get really pretty good with those graphemes, TH and CH, she adds in SH and WH, and then sort of, again, returns to the practice with TH and CH in lesson six. So this is just an example. She's got a whole sequence of lessons here. You know, it's her dissertation, so I can't really make it available to you guys, but you can see here that there's not really any, it's like you could do this with any curriculum. If you have a phonics curriculum, you can pair this handwriting instruction in with the phonics curriculum and give kids practice with their handwriting skills at the same time. And it will reinforce the spelling patterns. So that's handwriting skills. Another thing that we would want to practice are spelling skills, right? And spelling can improve decoding skills, right? So there is a lot of literature. Linnea Airy talks about this, how reading and spelling are one and the same. They're two sides of the same coin, right? In one case, we're decoding. When we decode words, we have to segment words into different sounds. And then we have to blend those sounds back together. And when we're encoding, we have to take a sound that's a whole word, like the word chat, and then we have to segment it, and then we have to represent each of the sounds that we hear, right? So decoding and encoding are very similar skills. So what we can do is we can teach spelling to improve decoding skills. But at the same time, we also can teach spelling patterns to help kids build their orthographic knowledge, like what letter patterns go together to make certain sounds, and that can help them with word reading skills. And then we can build in morphology. We can teach meaning, and I'm going to show a couple of examples for how to do each of these things. So one thing that we can do is keyword instruction. So if we're talking about word families, today we're going to learn a new keyword. What is a keyword? And the student would say, it's a special word that helps us remember a spelling pattern, because we've been teaching them these things. So we say, the keyword is talk. Everyone, what word? And they say talk. The spelling pattern for talk is awk. What's the spelling pattern for talk? Awk. Look at what we can do with the keyword talk. If I know talk, then I can read these words. Walk, stalk, balk, chalk, right? So what you're doing is you're teaching kids that there's a spelling pattern here that represents a sound, and that we can change some of the other letters that go with that sound to make other words. Right. Some really helpful phonograms are, you know, some that you might know are like ing, ing, all for, or all for all, ave for ave, old for old, right? So you can see some of these here. These are all really useful, and they work with several words, right? So what we're doing again is teaching them that here's a phonogram. It's a group of letters that represents a sound that's common, and we can create several words with these. Another thing that we might want to do is use orthographic analysis and word memory, right? So this is the word through. Spell it through. T-H-R-O-U-G-H. T-H-R-O-U-G-H. Good. Close your eyes. Spell the word. Sorry. So I think the animations were out of order. So you know, they would spell it again with the close their eyes. We have the word through there. Sorry, all of my animations are out of order. I don't know what happened. I think I transferred the slide from one thing to another, and I didn't test the animations there. So what we could do is have them make the word green in their mind. What's the second letter? What's the second to last letter? So they have to think about what are those letters? Oh, H and G. Think about where they are represented in the word. So really having a picture of the orthography in their mind. How do those letters go together in that word, right? Sorry about that, it threw me off a little bit. So then here's another sort of example of a phonics slash spelling lesson design. So if we're teaching a new sound, we would teach like a new sound spelling or phonogram. We would say, CH says ch. What does CH say? Child says ch. What letters say ch? CH. So we can ask them both directions, right? We can then blend written words to say, use sound spellings or phonograms. Say the sound for each spelling. So stay, they have to say st-a. Say it slowly, then read it. Stay, stay, right? And then we go to number three, where we read and spell high frequency words. This is who, what word? Who, yes, who, W-H-O, spell it, W-H-O. So the student has to really think about those letters. We're reinforcing the names of the letters, we're reinforcing the order of those letters in those high frequency words. And then we practice encoding. The word is fish. What word? Fish. What's the first sound? Write it. And then the students write that sound, right? So really sort of linking that, you know, we have to think about the sounds as we're encoding those words. I like to do it a little differently. You know, another, you know, this one sort of keeps the writing for the end. What I like to do is sometimes include writing within the phonics lesson, right? So you can see a group of TH, SH, CH, right? And what we would ask kids to do is read those graphemes. And so what they would have to do going from left to right is say, ch, 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 right? So really saying those sounds, reading those individual graphemes, right? Now we're doing this in isolation. We can also do this in reading words. So that's just a separate part of my lesson usually. But then after we've read the graphemes, then I say, write the letters that make the ch sound. Write the letters that make the sh sound, right? And they can do this on whiteboards or on paper. And what we're doing is we're practicing those sounds, and we're reinforcing the grapheme phoneme correspondence there, if that makes sense. And the writing sort of helps us build that automaticity. Another sort of thing, this comes from Pam's dissertation. I just wanted to show you what we do is, so we can add handwriting and spelling in combination, right? And so we've got, after kids have read lots of graphemes and phonemes, then we can sort of have them write words and spell words. So we say, spell the word flip, spell the word flat, spell the word jump. They say the word, they have to unblend it. So the approach is, say the word flip, child says flip. Segment it, flip. Then they write flip. And practicing their proper strokes. And then they circle the best word. So they really are focused on their handwriting there. And then they can self-assess and then say as they're circling what they think is their best word. We build it into sentence writing. So the rabbit can jump and run. They talk about what the sentence means, dictate the sentence, and then they practice writing the sentence word by word. And so they're practicing their handwriting and spelling in context. Right. And then we do here, which what Pam did is, and after they've really practiced this and they've thought about the sounds, then she adds in this handwriting piece where they're just copying. The rabbit can jump and run. And what she's doing is having kids write the sentence at their top of their writing journal as many times as they can in 2 minutes. And so they have to write neatly. They're told that they have to still circle their best letters and they have to circle their best words, but they try to build fluency and automaticity in that letter writing, but within the context of that word. Another strategy for building spelling skills is morphological word families, right? So I talked about morphemes at the beginning of the spelling. Morphemes are the smallest unit of sound that has meaning with it, right? And so so an S can be an S at the end of a word, or the S sound at the end of a word can be a morpheme. So we've got like cat, we add S to cat and we get cats. That sound represents meaning, because now instead of having one cat, we have multiple cats, right? ED can be a morpheme, but we can also have base words that that can be morphemes. And an example of that would be like the word natural, right? Natural, if we try to break it apart into smaller units of sound, we can't get into anything smaller that would be, if we get to nature, sorry, we did nature, that would be the word. But anyway, then what we can do is we can add different morphemes onto that word, right? So we've got supernatural, supernaturally, preternaturally, naturalism, naturalistic, denatured, et cetera. And so by teaching morphological word families, we can teach kids how to identify parts of words that they know and how those sounds and graphemes go together. What we like to do is teach a variety of these words, but then use the words that are likely known, right? Especially for students who are having difficulty. They may have difficulty with like a word like preternaturally, they may not need to learn, right? So what we might do is pick out the words that we think are the ones that are more likely to know. So you can see nature, natured, natures, naturally. Those are words that they're more likely to hear often. And then fade out words like naturalistically or supernaturalism, words that they may not come across as often. So what we want to do is, again, try to reduce the cognitive load for kids and focus on the letters and sounds that they would hear often.
Michael, it's interesting because I was working with a seventh grade young lady that was quite dyslexic, and she did not attend to the detail of the word. She guessed at the word based on what she saw. And so I had her go through this same process where I write the word natural, now I write supernatural, now I write supernaturally. And she had to know where to take stuff off and put stuff back on. Forced her to pay attention to the whole word and then read the whole family going down once they were done with that. And so it's interesting to see this right here, because that's kind of exactly what we're doing.
So what we talk about is sort of peeling off, affixes and so doing that, we can sort of cover up parts of the word with cards. We can peel things off and we can help kids see the word that we're really trying to help them learn. And so it sounds like you came across that, and it's a very effective strategy. What we tend to do with kids with dyslexia is we will tend to focus on teaching them, they need to know how to decode words. So we'll teach them phonics skills, right? And we teach them phonics skills in first grade, and they still have difficulty with it. And we get to second grade and we're like, oh, we got to give them more phonics skills. And then in third grade, we give them more phonics skills. And so we're sort of hitting them with phonics again and again and again. And it's important to do that. I don't want to take anything away, but sometimes we might say we need another way in. And morphemes can be that extra way in, right? So what we want kids to do eventually is to be able to consolidate their skills. It is very inefficient to sound out a word as long as something like natural, or especially words as long as like supernaturally. So if I try to sound that out, I would say by the time I get to the end, I've forgotten the sounds at the beginning of the word, right? So it is very inefficient for us to do that. So what we need to do as good readers is we need to chunk words, right? We need to see parts that we know and then say those chunks. Now we have to teach kids to read letter by letter to start, but we want to get to the point where we're consolidating the skills and teaching them chunks, right? Kids who have dyslexia, they're having trouble blending, identifying sounds, sounding out words, seeing all the way through the word and blending it. So one thing that we can try to do is help them to chunk. And so doing this with morphological word families can help both their spelling skills, because we, like John's example, if you're having them write the word again and again, and then read through the list of words. So you're building the spelling, and then they're really getting good at seeing the word natural. They're writing it 4, 5, 6 times in all of these words, right? And then they get really good at seeing that pattern and then recognizing that word when they read it. If that makes sense. So I didn't have a lot of activities in that part of the talk because, I didn't want to have you guys practicing handwriting skills or practicing spelling skills so much. But I'm going to have some more like interactive components to this. So now we're getting into sentence writing skills. One of the things that we found is if we can teach sentence writing skills, it actually improves kids' reading fluency. So why might that be? Well, one of the things that we figured out in looking at some of these studies and the theory behind it is that as kids are writing more complex sentences, they learn to read more complex sentences. So I'm going to share with you an example of a strategy called sentence combining that I think is very underutilized in schools. And I'll talk about why I use sentence combining and how that can help build fluency. And we'll see some examples along the way. Remembering our intervention strategies. We talked about remediation of foundational skills, but then I also mentioned compensation, right? So far, when I talk about handwriting skills and spelling skills, what am I focused on? I'm focused on remediation, right? I'm trying to build those skills. But sometimes I want kids to write longer text. I want them to focus on their ideas. I want them to focus on organization. I want them to focus on syntax of sentences. So what I can try to do is I can try to provide an accommodation for the students' challenges that will help reduce the cognitive load, help them forget about letter formation for a minute, or forget about handwriting, or forget about the sounds of the letters and forget about like the spelling, and then they can focus on a different skill, right? Before I show you how I do that, I'm gonna have a little writing activity to put you in the shoes. So I want you to feel what it's like to be a student like Jordan for a minute. You guys probably haven't felt like that in a long time. So I'm gonna have you do a writing prompt and it's about my most memorable school year. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna give you 30 seconds to plan and 3 minutes to write, okay? So, and what I need people to do is grab paper and a pencil. If you don't have paper and a pencil or a pen nearby, I suppose I could let you keyboard, but if I let you keyboard, it's like, what would be, you'll see these rules in a second. I'm going to give you some new rules as you're preparing. So I might be able to let you keyboard, but only, try to find some paper and pen first. Right. Now I'm going to give you some new rules before I start. And those rules are the following. You have to include a period after every fifth word. You've got to put quotation marks around every verb. You've got to capitalize every five-letter word. You've to spell every four-letter word backward. And you have to write with your non-dominant hand. And so this is why I said, you know, I want you to have paper and pencil. If you are keyboarding, if you absolutely have to, then I want you to keyboard with your opposite hands. So I want you to be keyboarding like this. So remember our prompt. I'm going to give you 30 seconds. I'll just go back to the prompt for a second. It's my most memorable school year. I'm going to leave the rules up, and I'm going to give you 30 seconds to plan starting now. All right, now I'll give you 3 minutes to write starting now. Go ahead and write. About another minute, I think. Take about 10 more seconds to finish up your last sentence. And, you know, I only gave you 3 minutes, so we can go ahead and put your pencils down now, but, or put an ellipses at the end of what you're writing, you know, if you want to keep going with it later. You know, I only gave you 3 minutes, so you probably didn't have a lot of time to develop these ideas, but don't worry, I'm not grading your writing. And I'm not gonna ask you to share it with partners and stuff unless you want to. Is there anybody who would like to share what they wrote? Yeah, great, Allison, go ahead.
I took up most of the time trying to figure out what my most memorable year was, and by the time I decided to start, well, yeah, So all I have is I don't remember what my most memorable, and that's as far as I got.
Yeah.
Because I kept forgetting the rule and I made a spelling error and it's like, oh great, remember it's spelled wrong. So I have to start over again.
Yeah. Yeah. How many people have kids that do that, right? Like they make a mistake in their spelling and they're like, oh, I've got to go back. And then they're focused so much on those rules that they might look back at the rules and they forget what they don't really have a chance to sort of elaborate on their ideas, right? So thanks for sharing that, Allison. Is there anybody else that would like to share their experience a little bit?
I found, Michael, that I was all of a sudden shortening what I was going to say. Once I started to write, I realized, oh, I'm not going to get anywhere in 3 minutes. And the other was, I'm going to keep this simple now. So it really limited content that in my mind. It was like, okay, I'm into survival mode. I am not into creation mode.
Yeah. And we don't usually feel that way. It's I think it's important to remember that kids feel that way sometimes, right? As they're writing. And so they might, and you know, as we saw with Jordan, maybe limited some of the word choices that he made or things like that, right? To as he was writing so that he could sort of make it through. It looks like Daria wrote the physical writing was hard. She had to keep thinking about the spelling, couldn't remember the punctuation capitalization without looking back at the rules. A lot of kids who can't write wouldn't be able to read the rules that are posted. And that's true, right? Sometimes those rules are sort of arbitrary, right? Like I think that, you know, my rules were actually, you know, include a period after every fifth word. You guys can count those words. You can put the period after the fifth word, right? But if you ask kids where to put punctuation, it's a lot more arbitrary than that, right? They're like, oh, it's at the end of a complete thought, right? And, you know, it has to have, you know, subject and a predicate. You have to tell the who or what or what they're doing. And so kids have to think about a lot more that's really challenging around where to put that period, right? And you're right, they wouldn't be able to read the posted rules, but we do have rules like this posted around our classrooms at times, right? Stephanie wrote, counting for the period after the fifth word slowed down her thought process even more. Went back in the middle of the words to put the period in, went back while writing mid-word. Yeah, and so, you know, we see kids do that too, right? They'll be in the middle of a thought and they'll forget, oh, I've got to go and put this period in. And then, you know, again, they lose their train of thought. They're not focused on the content anymore. And it really impacts the ideas that they include, right? Anybody else want to share anything about, you know, their writing?
I know I spoke before, but in my head, I'm thinking about, as a school psychologist, when I give my written expression or the sentence composition, and I watch the children as they're writing, and some of them, I'll mark them off for the punctuation, and then they'll come back and fix it. And
I'm like, right.
Now I'll be more sympathetic towards them after going through this.
Yeah, absolutely, right? And you know, it's hard when you're giving standardized tests because you have to administer them the same way every time, and there's a reason for that. But we put kids in these positions where they have to, where we're sort of seeing the challenges, and we sometimes forget why they're having these difficulties, right? Or what they might be going. It's sort of hard for us to analyze exactly what's going on with them. So what could we do to help compensate a writer and help them focus on, or help a writer compensate for their, you know, there's challenges with some foundational skills and focus on their ideas more? What are some things that we could do? It's okay if you guys don't have, you probably have strategies you use all the time, right? I'm going to just talk about, Morgan says we could sometimes ignore some rules and focus on content. Absolutely. And we do that. We'll tell kids, just get the writing out, you know, just don't worry about your spelling, just write your ideas, things like that. And that can be really helpful for kids. Some kids, I still get the kids that are like, I have to have it spelled right. I'm not going to go on until I know that I have the right spelling, right? I see Allison nodding. So we see these kids who just can't, but I think we can, that it is a strategy that can work for some children. Right. So that's something that we can try to do. Another thing we can try to do is isolate. So we can say like, what exactly is the skill that I want to teach? And sometimes, you know, I'm going to go back to like what my skill was is sentence writing. So I want them to write more complex sentences, right? So I have a little example of a child's writing that might benefit from sentence combining. So when a child in an affluent neighborhood was asked to write a story about a poor family, she chose her own. Once upon a time, there was a poor family. The father was poor. The mother was poor. The children were poor. The nannies were poor. The pool man was poor. The personal trainer was poor, right? This student has maybe some perspective problems around like what does poor mean, but also maybe could you benefit from a little bit of sentence combining here, right? So, one thing that we could teach this student to do would be to say, you know, the father and mother were poor. The children were poor, the nannies, pool man, and personal trainer were poor, right? So like combining sentences to make more complex sentences. And as we do that, students will learn how to read those more complex sentences. When they see things like commas or lists within a sentence, they might be able to read those a little bit better. And that's what we found in our research. I really like sentence combining. It's one of, I think, the most underutilized strategies in schools. I will talk to teachers. I'll go into a school and I'll ask them about, do you use sentence combining? And in some schools, none of the teachers know what sentence combining is, right? You don't see it in a lot of curricula, but it's a very powerful strategy. And I'm going to show different ways to do this. Now, sentence construction in general can be really helpful. I'm going to focus on sentence combining because of the underutilization of it. So it helps improve kids' writing skills. It helps them with their organization, their grammar. It outperforms grammar instruction, actually. If we teach kids like strict grammar instruction, or we do like sentence diagramming or things like that, and we compare it to sentence combining, which has been done in a lot of experiments, sentence combining wins out almost every time. It helps improve the sentence variety for kids. Kids will use lots of different types of sentences. And because of that, it also helps them improve their oral language skills, which will help with idea generation and things like that. And then it also helps improve their reading fluency, because as they write more complex sentences, they're able to read more complex sentences. So where can it be used? It can be used in kindergarten, as early as kindergarten. You might think, well, gosh, you know, in kindergarten, kids may be learning to write letters or learning to write words for the first time. So one of the things we can do to lay the foundation for writing is by doing some of these things orally. They can do oral sentence combining practice, and I'll show some examples of that. And that will lay the foundation for written sentence combining. In first grade, you can do oral and written. Second grade, and then third grade, you might do more written than oral, and so on. So you might do a combination of oral and written. And I'm gonna talk about the benefits of that a little bit later. All right, so here's some teaching tips around oral sentence combining. So I'm going to start with oral. What we might do is use simple sentences at first with kids, right? So with kindergartners, we might say like, apples are fruit, bananas are fruit. I want you to connect those two sentences, and I want you to use the word and, right? So they might say, you know, I'm giving them a connector word. I'm saying apples are fruit, bananas are fruit. So they might say apples and bananas are fruit, right? Other kids might say apples are fruit and bananas are fruit. So they might take the whole sentence and they might combine it that way. Either is acceptable, right? Either is an acceptable sentence. Doing a compound subject saying apples and bananas are fruit is more efficient way to write the sentence but they're both grammatically okay. And so what we can do is we can talk to kids about why might we make certain choices, you know, when we're saying sentences. Well, we might want to, we want to use fewer words, or we want to keep it short, or whatever. And so, but both sentences would be correct. As kids start to figure out, you know, how to do this task, what we can do is we can give them challenges. We can build in some complexity. So what I might do is I might say, now I told you in the last example, or, you know, we've been telling you for the last few lessons, you know, to use and or to use but. Now I'm going to have you combine sentences. You have to think about the ideas and you have to decide if you're going to use and or but. Right. So in the first example, you might say, Anne knew the answer. Sergio did not know the answer. What do you have to use? Can you use and, or can you use but, or can you use both? Which one might you use? And why? So in this case, you know, what we might do is we might say that, you know, you would probably not use and because they're two sort of different ideas, right? So Anne knew the answer, Sergio did not. They're sort of contrasting, right? So Anne knew the answer, but Sergio did not know the answer. You could say Anne knew the answer and Sergio did not know the answer, but it's sort of a little bit harder for your listener to understand what you're trying to say, right? Like it sort of is a little harder for your listener to follow, right? So using the word but would help there. In example two, Anne knew the answer, Sergio knew the answer. There the kids might say, oh yeah, they both knew the answer. So and is the appropriate word to use there, right? So you can kind of challenge them by building in some complexity. Another thing that I really love about sentence combining and oral practice is that you can have kids, you know, you can increase opportunities to respond and give kids more opportunities to practice by doing stuff like partner practice. So what I might do is I might say kernel sentences, ask the students to think about how to combine them, and then have them turn and say it to a partner. And then I'll ask one pair to share with the group, right? So I'll say something like, the dog was cold, the dog was wet, we're going to use the word and to combine those. And so so then if I was doing this presentation live, I might have you like turn to your neighbor. It's a little harder in Zoom, but you can see that I would have you pair up. And by doing that, lots of kids in the class have to think about, you know, how they would combine those sentences and get that practice for doing it, right? And then I can ask one group to share out what their answer was, right? Now, what am I working on here? What's the skill? What's the grammatical skill that I'm working on? Or the part of, yeah. So if I said the dog was cold, the dog was wet, probably I'm going to do like the dog was cold and wet, right? So there, I think in my last example with apples are fruit, bananas are fruit, it was like apples and bananas are fruit. I was working on compound subjects, right? Now I'm working on compound predicates. Really, you know, sort of focusing on the subject of the sentence or the predicate of the sentence, right? And what's great about this is that I didn't have to tell the kids that I don't have to teach them the words subject or predicate. And those things are important to teach, you know, and don't get me wrong. But sometimes what I'll do is I'll ask teachers, you know, like who can tell me what a past participle is? So if usually somebody in the group can tell me, right? But I see Tanya laughing because Tanya, do you know what a past participle is? Could you define it for me? No, right. So, and you know, I use this one because I have trouble defining what a past participle is. And I use this example a lot and I purposely never go look it up because I have difficulty with, but we all use past participles. And Tanya, you can use a past participle like really well because you know how to use the language and you've got a lot of practice using those things, right? And so even if you're, even if you don't know what it's called, you can use it correctly, right? And so this is why sentence combining instruction beats out grammar instruction often in these things, because kids can work on these skills without necessarily having to learn all the terminology around it. Right. And so I don't know if anybody has anything they want to say about that, but another thing that we can do is we can incorporate content from other subject areas, right? So this is another really great way to use sentence combining. It can help us, focus on content, help them build content knowledge in a particular area while also doing some writing, right? So Utah is a Western state, New Mexico is a Western state, Utah and New Mexico are Western states, right? And so they would focus on a compound subject, and you have to actually change the to be verb there, right? The form of it from is to are, right? Two is a prime number, four is not a prime number. Combine those with the word but, right? And then kids have to combine those sentences, but they're also again, focusing on the content that they're learning in math that day.
Michael, yeah. Anita Archer has rewards writing, and the focus of that is twofold. One is sentence combining, the other is using alternate synonyms or word choice. And so when I was a principal, we implemented that as an intervention with all of our sixth and seventh graders. They got really good pretty fast with sentence combining. With using alternate synonyms, they did it indiscriminately without really understanding the nuances and which ones were appropriate and not appropriate for that kind of substitution. But from a standpoint of sentence combining, it worked pretty darn well.
Yeah, yeah. It's incredibly effective. When we see, remember earlier when I said effect size is 0.8, you're dancing on the moon. We see studies with sentence combining that you'll see an effect size of 1.2 or 1.3. So really huge effects for kids writing. Kids write more, they write more complex sentences. Their quality of their writing improves. It's very impressive what you can actually do, which is why I'm spending so much time on it here. You can also do some really fun things where you can incorporate novel vocabulary into sentence combining. Now, here I've got a couple of sentences. I've got a new word that I'm teaching, the word dense, right? And I have a student-friendly definition, lots of parts crowded together. Not a great definition. We had some students come up with these definitions for this study. Sometimes they had sentences like, gorillas have chests. Their chests are durable. So combined with gorillas have durable chests, which I thought was really hilarious. But here, they dense, lots of parts crowded together. Okay, we had them come up with a student-friendly definition that we could share. And then we combine sentences. Anteaters have dark fur. Their fur is dense. What would be the way that we would combine that sentence? Anybody just write it in the chat. Everybody else is hoping that somebody else will do it, probably. So, anteaters have dense dark fur. All right, so great. So thank you all for doing this. Now I've done we've done multiple adjectives, right? We're doing how do you write sentences, and how do you use it's not compound adjectives, but it's using multiple adjectives in the same sentence or to describe the same word. And you guys have put commas in, and it's great. One of the things, and Allison says, great job with the comma. I agree. And you can see that some people say dense dark fur or dark dense fur. I think in some cases, what we find is that there's a certain word order that sounds right to us. And in this case, I feel like you can go either way, but there are some cases with the kids where it just sounds better to have like one. So what we can do is when we're talking to kids, they might come up with some of those things as they're sharing their sentences. You can say, which one of those sounds better to you? Dense dark fur or dark dense fur? And it doesn't matter in most cases, but you can help them make choices as authors. Like, how do I want to represent my ideas, and which way, so even though we've narrowed the field here, we've given them words that they need to write about, and we've given them the ideas, they still have choices they can make as authors, and they still have a lot of things they can talk about that come up. All right, so this is something that we did for English learners in particular. Another thing that we did in this is that we found cognates. So if we were working we actually designed this intervention for both English learners and students with visual impairments. And you might think, those two populations are very different, and they are. Both have difficulty with adjective use, right? In Spanish-speaking dual language learner population, in Spanish, the adjective follows the noun. So we've got a couple of things that we can work on with adjectives. One is introducing new vocabulary, and two is sort of helping with, where do adjectives get placed in a sentence, right? Grammatically. For kids with visual impairments, they had difficulty using adjectives for a different reason. A lot of adjectives are visual in nature. Color words, for example. The word dark, thinking about something like that's very visual in nature is very difficult. And so they tend to not use those adjectives in their writing as much. And so we want to give them practice with those things. So in this case, we wanted to build on students' first language knowledge. So we give kids the word humid, we give a child-friendly definition, and then we also talk about the cognate. So we say the Spanish word for humid is húmedo, right? And so combine these sentences, anteaters live in the forest, the rainforest is humid. You guys have seen that already, but you kind of get the point here is that we can try to tailor the instruction a little bit for the learner, right? Right. And then another thing that we can do is we can ask kids to combine sentences one way or in more than one way and then compare. So what we might say is like, can you combine these sentences in more than one way? Now I've given you two very simple sentences here. The ball is red, the ball is bouncy. So go ahead and in the chat, try to come up with more than one way to combine those sentences. The bouncy ball is red. Great. The red ball is bouncy. Awesome. The red ball is bouncy. The bouncy ball is red. The ball is red and bouncy. Yep. Great. So awesome. Now there's obviously more than one way to do it. This can be really fun for kids as they try to figure out how many different ways can you combine the sentences, right? And you can make a game out of it. And then they can talk about, what choice would you make as an author? Which way do you think sounds the best, or what would you use? And so they really get to practice writing different types of sentences. Where do I want to put the adjective? Which adjective do I want to use? Things like that. And so, so it's really, really can be a lot of fun. Now, so I, as I was talking about this, all of those things that I talked about can be done orally, right? So so now what I want you to do is, I've got time for this. So now what I want you to do is I want you to try to develop an oral sentence combining activity. So what I want you to do is just, you're all in education, you're all teachers or school psychologists, I want you to think about a content or subject area really quick. And then think about one or two vocabulary words that you might want to teach in that area, right? And then identify, if you know it, if you don't know it, that's okay. If you know the Spanish word for the target vocabulary, great. If not, you could type it into Google and find out what is the word. Is there a cognate for that target vocabulary word? Or even if there's not a cognate, the student might know it in their primary language. So if you could identify the Spanish word for that target vocabulary word is, it could be really helpful for them. And then now that you've thought about that for a minute, I'll give you another minute to do that. Now I want you to write a meaningful sentence for the target word. For whatever the target word is that you have in your mind, I want you to write a sentence. And don't worry about how long it is. Just write us any sentence that has that word in it. Try not to make it too simple. But you don't have to make it overly complex, but if it is very complex sentence, that's okay. Go ahead and write a sentence down. And then what I'd like you to do is, once you've got a really solid sentence, I want you to try to then decombine it and try to create two kernel sentences that might work on a particular skill. Doesn't matter what those what the skill is so much. Just see if you can break it into two smaller sentences that you could use to have the kids combine. And then I'd love to hear your, I'd love to see either your whole, you know, your first sentence or the two kernel sentences in the chat if you're willing to share. And as you're sort of thinking about it or writing these things, the reason I'm doing this activity is that, you know, like I said, sentence combining is an underutilized skill. And because of that, it's like sometimes it's not in a lot of, you know, core programs, right? We don't see these activities in the core programs, but you can create activities like this pretty easily, right? Or you can find ideas for sentence combining activities pretty easily within the content areas that you're teaching, other content areas that you're teaching. So let's see, is anybody willing to share a couple of kernel sentences in the chat? Oh, great, Daria. Frogs are amphibians, toads are amphibians. Awesome. Really, really simple sentence, or doing compound subjects there, but we've taught the, you know, we're working on the word amphibians, which is awesome. So we're really focused on science. Probably you're gonna be talking to the kids about what amphibians are, right? And so they're learning new vocabulary, but also working on this writing skill. And by the way, I don't wanna give away the discussion for later, but I keep wanting to, but we are reducing cognitive load for kids. So I want you to kind of think about that. How are we reducing cognitive load by giving them these kernel sentences? So we'll come back to that in a minute. All right. So now a lot of that was oral, you know, we were coming up with these oral examples.
I'm sorry. You had a reminder statement. You wanted us to remind you about something before you forgot.
Will you remind me? I'm going to save that to the end of the, but yeah, okay. Will you remind me at the end? Thank you so much. All right. So now, that all of those activities can be done orally, right? I could give those, you know, I could give those examples in the dark. I could say frogs are amphibians, toads are amphibians. Can you combine those sentences, and kids can orally do those activities, right? So so all of the things that I said could be done orally. They can also be done in writing. So my tips for teaching written sentence combining are, well, the first tip is like, you can just do all the things that you did with the oral sentence combining. So why did I talk about oral sentence combining? Well, I really want you to think about, that's laying the foundation for those really young kiddos who may be having difficulty with writing, right? So I'm reducing the cognitive load by not requiring them to actually write. They can dictate the sentences orally, right? So we can help have them work on some of these oral language skills, you know, without working on the without getting hung up on the mechanics of writing. All right. Other things that you can do is that, you know, with written sentence combining, you can reinforce words that you really want the kids to learn. So going back to spelling, we're like, we want to teach high frequency words. You want to teach kids spelling patterns. So I want to, let's say I'm teaching kids spelling patterns around, you know, I want them to learn how to spell and but, or I want them to learn how to spell like, or play, or cat, or big. I can use those sentences, or I can use those words in the kernel sentences. I can use them a lot, and they can practice writing them a lot, right? So I like to play, I like to run, I like to run and play. And so they can really use those high frequency words quite a lot. And by doing that, reinforce the spelling and build automaticity, you know, for those words. Right? We can also add visual cues, right? One of the things that I like to do with writing, and I do this we did this a lot in our intervention with English learners, is we'll try to scaffold by like helping the kids see patterns, right? So in this example, she likes to run, she likes to jump. What we might do is show the kids that, oh, you know, she likes is shows up, or she likes to even shows up in both sentences, right? And so we don't have to use all of those words twice. We could say she likes to run and she likes to jump. But if we notice that these words are the same, we can just say that once, and then we can combine run and jump at the end of the sentence. So you can kind of help them see that by creating a visual cue with circling words. Another thing you might do, and this is what we did in our adjective intervention, is when we're showing kids like the sky has few clouds, the sky is hazy. We might circle the adjective, and we might say, you know, the adjective goes before the noun. What's the noun? And we might identify sky. Hazy is describing sky. So hazy is going to go before sky, right? And so then we can draw that out for them and show them where the adjective goes, and then they can combine the sentence, right? And so this could be a cue for kids who need a little bit more support. Another thing that we can do is we can build on phonics skills and spelling with rhymes. And I have rhymes spelled R-I-M-E-S because I'm talking about the vowel sound and everything after the vowel sound in the word. Words that have the same rhyme, R-I-M-E, rhyme, R-Y-M-E, right? So he is tall, she is small. We're teaching kids that phonogram all, right? A-L-L says all. And we're having them practice these, but in context of combining sentences. They played catch, they played at the match, they played catch at the match, right? So helping kids sort of practice their spelling and working on those phonics skills at the same time. Here's an example that I guess I would like to have you guys practice. So we've got, we'll just do one of these examples, or you can pick which example that you would like to do. And I'd love for you guys to put your example in the chat. So example one is the player dashed, dove, and jumped. He dashed down the line. He dove to the base. He jumped to his feet. Try to combine those into one sentence. You really feel like you want a challenge, and you see the six kernel example on the right, example two. If you want that challenge, go ahead and try to combine those into one sentence. All right, Morgan says, in the warm summer evenings, mom would sit happily on the porch and softly play the harmonica. I love that sentence. Really great. I think that you've captured all of the ideas, which that's what I always emphasize to the kids, that the ideas are the important part. And it does sound grammatically correct, right? And then Stephanie says, mom would sit on the porch in the warm summer evenings and happily but softly play her harmonica. So also a really nice sentence. I really like the way that that's put together. And you can see that these sentences are different from one another, but you can have the kids talk about, you know, what choices would you make as a writer? Which one do you think sounds the best? An idea that I heard recently is sort of like, hold that thought too for a second. I'm going to have us do one more. I've got Allison says, mom would softly and happily play her harmonica on warm summer evenings as she sat on the porch. And John, mom would play her harmonica softly and happily while she sat on the porch on warm summer evenings. All right. So now I'm going to play a game with you that's a little different. This game is called Beat the Author. And so I'm telling you that that what we've done is I've taken a paragraph from a piece of writing, and I've broken it up into these different sentences. And what I want you to do is I want you to combine these four activities, combine them into an overall paragraph, and then we're going to try to beat the author. And because we've got time constraints and stuff, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have John, Tanya, and Morgan, I want you to work on sentence one. Allison, Stephanie, and Kelly, I want you to work on the one that starts that girl sat. Catherine, John, and Mark, I'd like you to do she let herself. And then Timor, I don't know your first name, I'm sorry. And Daria, if you would do the last one, I saw her dancing around. Go ahead and combine the sentences. And what I'll do is we'll have us read the sentences. I'll have you guys each read your sentence, and we'll do it in an order so that we can see if we can beat the author. John's coming up with multiple examples. It's awesome.
This is really fun, actually, Michael. I'm having a good time.
Good, good.
I love wordsmithing, so.
Yeah. Awesome. It's got that girl sat on a fence in a raincoat on rainy days. Mark Scott, she acted like she did not care when she got all wet. Allison is coming back and saying, on rainy days, that girl sat on a fence in a raincoat.
We can't change the tense at all, like say sitting.
Oh yeah, you can change the tense if you like. Yep, absolutely. If you feel like it would sound better. Again, we're trying to beat the author, so. So the girl enjoyed sitting on a fence in a raincoat on rainy days. So maybe what we could do is I'm gonna have someone from group one read what they thought their best sentence was out loud. Why don't we have Tanya, why don't you read what you thought your best sentence was out loud?
It rained a lot that summer.
Great. And Allison, why don't you go ahead and read what you thought for sentence two, what you thought your best one was. Oh, you're muted, sorry.
The girl enjoyed sitting on a fence in a raincoat on rainy days.
Great. And then let's see. We've got Mark, will you go ahead and read the third sentence?
You mean the one I put together?
Yeah, the one that you.
Okay. Yep. She acted like she did not care when she got all wet.
Excellent. And then, Daria, you read your last sentence.
I put, sometimes I saw the laughing girl dancing and splashing in puddles, but I think it's awkward.
That's okay. Yeah, that's all right. I mean, I think, you know, so what we do here, and then that's great. I mean, it might sound awkward and we can play with it, but I think that that's great. So thank you for sharing that. All right. So now what we might do in this situation is if I had all of you doing different ones, what then I could do is I could put them up on the board, and we could, you know, anonymize them and then see if we would beat the author. We can share what the author actually wrote, and then people in the class could vote about which one that they thought was the best. And so here's what the author actually wrote. This is Jacqueline Woodson, 2001. It says, "It rained a lot that summer. On rainy days, that girl sat on the fence in a raincoat. She let herself get all wet and act like she didn't even care. Sometimes I saw her dancing around in puddles, splashing and laughing," right? So it's pretty well written, but you could see how it could be really fun for us and for kids to see, like, you know, what did we come up with? And do we like ours better than the author, right? And then that really builds agency with the kids and helps them think of themselves as authors. And they're the ones making choices about how they can put sentences together, right? So so anyway, kids can have a lot of fun with that one. You know, another thing that we can do with kids is we can, if we were looking for these types of activities, is we can decombine students' reading material for them. So if we want to find sentences, we can go into their social studies text and say, you know, grab this sentence: "The European army stood shoulder to shoulder. Stood shoulder to shoulder, and the soldiers fired shots at each other until one side broke and ran." So what I would have you do is do what I won't have you do it this time, just in the interest of time. I want to have some time for discussion, but you did it earlier, is you took your own sentence and you decombined it into two kernels. And then you would try to, like, you know, and you could decide, do you want to decombine into two or three? How difficult do you want to make it for kids? And they can have a lot of fun, like, learning the content and practicing their writing at the same time. Finally, you know, what we can do is use students' own writing for these exercises, right? It will help them with their stories. It will help improve engagement and motivation, and it will help them with skills that they need today that they're using in their current writing, right? So I'm going to give you an example. Revisiting Jordan, right? One of the things, he was writing about Battleship, right? And so I've got some sentences, kernel sentences here for Jordan. "I like Battleship. I get to play it with friends. The ships are big because," right? So I want Jordan now to, like, combine these sentences into, you know, one complete sentence. And if we look at his writing, you know, this is where I pulled it from. "The game is Battleships. I like it because I get to play with friends, and I like ships because they're big," right? And so now I'm trying to challenge him to write that sentence in a different way, you know, and took these kernel sentences, and I, you know, and then he could talk about it with his classmates and say, well, you know, how could I write this sentence in the best way, right? And so you can see how that could be really engaging for kids. So I'm going to leave Jordan up here. And what I want to do is sort of jump into questions and discussion. We've got about, you know, 15 minutes here left. And what I want you to do is sort of think about the, you know, at the beginning I talked about, you know, different strategies, remediating certain skills, compensating for skills. And I also want to revisit this topic, this thing about handwriting. But before I do, I want you to kind of look at Jordan's writing again, and how can these strategies help Jordan? What are some of the things that, you know, if you were to pick some strategies to teach based on the things that that we saw, what are some things that you might do with Jordan? Stephanie says sentence combining. Yeah. start with oral sentence combining? Absolutely. Yeah. I think. Yeah. And what, why?
Yeah.
Why? What would we be doing there? Yeah. Sort of reducing that cognitive load, right? We'd be taking away the kid doesn't have to think about how to spell the words, doesn't have to think about how to form, you know, we see that this student's having difficulty with handwriting skills, so doesn't have to think about handwriting at the moment, and then could just think about how the sentences, how the ideas go together, right? Grammatically. Oh, great. Yeah. good. Yeah. So you're getting it. That's perfect. I mean, yeah. That's exactly what I'm getting after here. So what else? Daria Ross says memory, right? So yeah, we're offloading, you know, all the challenges, you know, with memory, right? So doesn't have to keep all of these things, the spelling and everything else in working memory all at the same time. And so we've offloaded some of that. Written sentence combining can really help offload a lot of things. So you've got the sentences here. This is one of the points I wanted to make earlier, but I was holding off on it. If I want to reduce cognitive load, what are things that the student doesn't have to do when they're doing an example like this? What are the things that I've sort of like taken away and reduced cognitive load?
You're asking what should you expect when you take that away?
No. What are some of the things that I've sort of how have I reduced the cognitive load here by giving them this exercise instead of asking him to write sentences on his own? It does.
Don't have to come up with a topic.
Yeah, it doesn't have to come up with the ideas. And Mark, what were you going to say?
I was going to say it helps just even visually simplifying.
Absolutely, right? So now, you know, what we've done is we've written some of those challenging words for him, right? Doesn't have to think about the spelling of those words, right? And can just focus on how to put the ideas together. Doesn't have to come up with friends, right? So like we sort of reduced that load. What else?
I appreciated I'll use this term and it may make some shudder, but that the mentor text aspect, right? So
yeah,
done a lot of professional learning lately where you analyze something an author has done and then you try to emulate it, right? And so you after challenges within emulation and challenges like beat the author. But I think when we're doing something that's, well, A, it's something we see that we know somebody else can do. And then when we see we can do it, or practice it, or maybe even be better than it, it builds our confidence. But I also think it takes it away from your own personal, I hate to say it, but Daria shared something and I'm so glad that she did, but she was quick to say, this sounds awkward. So there's that fine line between her even submitting that and feeling awkward. And when you talk about somebody else's, or you're using it in the context of something other than your idea, it builds that confidence for him to now come back and say, oh, I just did this in this other writing, I can do it here too.
Absolutely. Yeah, I am so glad you said that, right? So I think that kids will, you know, writing is so personal, and we're asking kids to tell their story or come up with a story. They write it and they're worried, you know, did I come up with good ideas? Did I, you know, like, am I entertaining my audience and stuff? If you've given them ideas, then you've sort of taken away some of that anxiety. Now you might still come up like Daria did with something. You're like, well, I'm still not sure. It still feels a little awkward. That's okay. It's a lot less pressure than you might have had if it was your own ideas and you weren't really sure about them, right? I participated in a writing group last night and I was like, I had to share, and I was like, I don't want to share. I was going to say,
even as an adult, sometimes I'm still insecure about what I do.
That's right. Yeah. So we maybe reduce some of the emotional load in addition to the cognitive load, and maybe we can build in some motivation by doing some things like beat the author, you know. So that's great. So those are some of the things that I do, right? Like I think that again, sort of thinking about remediating skills, compensating for skills. We can, there are a lot of other strategies I could share, but though, when it boils down to it, it's those are the two big things, right? I want to teach kids certain skills and I want to do it in a way that makes sense, right? If I'm capitalizing on the shared knowledge of those skills, right? Decoding and encoding, handwriting, as I'm practicing handwriting letters, I can say the letter, I can say the sound, and I can capitalize on that experience. And you can, your instruction can be a lot more efficient that way. One of the things that I really, you know, I said, I asked for the reminder and somebody tried to remind me earlier about when I said, I wanted to make a point about why handwriting is so important at the early level. A lot of times now what we think is we see handwriting sort of disappear out of the curriculum, right, or out of the standards, right? And we're saying it's not so important. And we assume that kids are going to be on devices and they're gonna keyboard and they're gonna do that. But one of the things that I think that I've seen a lot is that kids aren't really keyboarding. We're not teaching kids how to keyboard, right? And when they are on devices, a lot of times, most of the time it's a touchscreen and they're swiping or they're clicking on things, right? They know how to do that really well. But when it comes to keyboarding, it's really difficult for them still, or can be at times, right? For very young kids, kindergarten, first grade, if they don't know their letters and you give them, you know, a QWERTY keyboard and you're like, find the letters that you need to write the thing that you want to write, that's really challenging, right? They've got to like recognize the letter, find it among a sea of other keys. That can be really difficult. And I think that, you know, I showed that as kids are learning to handwrite those letters, they can attach the letter names and attach the sounds to those letters and really sort of figure out, this is the shape of the letter, this is how I form it, and I've got, you know, it sort of consolidates all that knowledge together, right? So I just really wanted to make that point because we're seeing handwriting disappear, and I think that's a real mistake, I think. So if you have opportunities to include handwriting instruction, you only need, you know, with distributed practice, you know, like 5 minutes here, 10 minutes there across, you know, each day. So. Anyway, I'll stop talking and a lot of other people, I'll let you guys ask questions.
It was a long time ago in your presentation, Michael, but in the letters training program, they talk mm-hmm. about a scope and sequence for reading and spelling being pretty much the same in first grade, but in second grade, it's a different scope and sequence because they deem spelling to be more difficult and taking more a longer time to develop than the reading will. I was curious if that impacted some of the routines or activities that where you were looking at letter sounds and you'd want to do those when they were reading them as well, but that divergence in the scope and sequence, I wondered if that was ever addressed.
Yeah, you know, I think that I haven't seen a lot of that in the literature. It is, you do see sort of spelling lag behind a little bit, right? In terms of like, you know, kids can sometimes, they see spelling patterns or they can work with more complex spelling patterns sometimes than they can read them more before they can write them, you know, mm-hmm. often. But, you know, what I would say is that, you know, I could probably take most spelling skills and I can incorporate lots of different activities, right? So if for example, if I'm teaching long A words and I'm thinking that, you know, some kids are really, I need to teach them how to decode long A words, maybe like, you know, words with AI or AY or A consonant E or EIGH, right? I can teach these spelling patterns, and for, I can differentiate within the class. So some kids may be reading multi-syllable words that have long A patterns, like playful, right? Whereas other kids may be like practicing the word play, right? And so I think what you can do is you can build in some, if you want to teach some more complex reading skills, you can kind of build in some more complex words into, you know, the spelling patterns that you're teaching at a more basic level. So I'm teaching AY, but I'm also introducing and reading the FUL, you know, suffix. So I'm teaching like things like playful in reading. So there are ways that you can kind of align those things. It's a lot of work for teachers. And so I do think that we see spelling start to lag behind a little bit. But I would also point to, if they can spell it, they can read it. You know, so I would like take the time to work on those spelling skills.
A couple minutes left, folks. Any other questions or comments? You will be getting an email from Sarah.
I'm supposed to. Is this slide? I'm supposed to.
Yeah, no, that's all right. They'll be getting that, and you'll get a link to do an evaluation, but also information on how to access the recording and the PowerPoint. So at that point, so. Michael, again, we surely appreciate this. Like I said, that I really got into your activities. Those were fun. So I appreciate you doing that with us. And really good ideas to look in. And the big news is they're evidence-based, right? They have a track record.
Is there an evaluation link?
There, you'll get an email requesting you to do an evaluation.
Oh, sorry. It sounds like you just said that. Sorry.
That's all right. I like hearing myself.
Yeah. And I had it on the slide. So it said that, you know, there's an evaluation link. So, I don't have it to put in the chat, but.
Nor do I. So, but they do come out automatically afterwards. But we appreciate you guys giving your time and spending time with us today.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it, everyone. All of your contributions and your willingness to try the activities, because I think sometimes putting yourself in the shoes of a student that's doing the activity can really help you see the benefit of that activity or how it can be used. So.
Yeah, I hope I remember this the next time I go to test. Yeah. I have a feeling I will remember how challenging it was. I'll definitely be more sympathetic.
Right. I think you mentioned if the kids learn that sentence commanding, they'll ace the... test of written language.
It's very rare that I see a child do well even on the essay response on the Wyatt, and whenever I see it, folks don't understand, I get all excited because it seems like writing is a lost art, like it's not even that important anymore, and it's just nice to see those skills when children do well in them.
Well, I think that's the thing. I think if teachers understood how powerful writing could be, what happens is it takes time, and right, it feels like it's slow when you're incorporating writing into your classroom. It takes, you know, it takes kids a while to write a sentence. You could read three or four sentences in the time you could write one, and then teachers feel like they have to give feedback on all the sentences. And I think that, you know, some of the activities that I showed, peers can be giving each other feedback and talking about those sentences. You don't have to give feedback on everything. But because of those things, teachers will tend to not ask their kids to write as much in class. And I think that's a mistake. I think if we take the time to do it, it's really powerful and kids can really benefit. So.
Well, again, thank you, everyone. And especially to you. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, you bet. So I'm going to go ahead and end this. Mark Raffler, thank you, Mark, for putting in the sketch link. That also should have been in your invite as well, if you want to get sketches for this. Otherwise, just have a good evening, folks.
What's a sketch?
Continuing education units.
Oh, cool. Oh, nice.
Yeah. State continuing education.
Oh, okay.
Something, something. Clock hours or something. Yeah, clock hours. So SECH.
All right. Well, thanks, John. Thanks for everything.
No, thank you, Michael. This was great. And, you know, I was thinking this was going to be primarily for early L, but as one of the people shared, she's a secondary ELA teacher. It's going, oh, I'm seeing the value of doing this at her level too. So it really transcended the levels nicely.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think that some of the skills need to be remediated even at later levels, but then the sentence combining, you could really go up with it. You can really make some challenging activities. And like you said, you were having fun with